Many years ago, when I first moved to Seattle, my husband Vishy, my eldest brother Rich, and his wife Karen and I all went to Olympic National Park. We wanted to experience the natural beauty of the Pacific Northwest. We thoroughly enjoyed our daytime activity of hiking through the rainforest. But at night, it was so dark that it seemed like there were a million twinkling stars shining down upon us. It was stunning. This experience reminded me of my childhood nights when my siblings and I would venture outdoors to identify planets and constellations from our very own backyard. Gazing at the stars has always made me feel at one with the universe and very humble for the tiny part that I play on this planet. This humbling experience is one that I think we share with each other and all the humans who have gone before us. Seeing the stars makes my troubles dissipate, and life is good. For me, the night is essential because it provides balance and perspective to my daily routine. As an archaeologist, I look to such experiences to find connections with people who have lived in other times and other places. There are a lot of misconceptions about what archaeology is. The main goal is to understand and reconstruct the vast array of human cultures, some of which have disappeared. We can do that better by studying ancient nights. Think about all of the things that you do at night and how they differ substantially from what you do during the day. Sleeping, sex, socializing, partying, sneaking around, all of those things come to mind. If we don't study the night, we're missing out on all of those activities and much more. If you think of tourists, they typically visit sites during the day. And archaeologists typically excavate sites during the day. And all of that allows us to envision what it's like to live during the day in the past. We typically do not experience archaeological sites at night. So we typically do not think about what ancient people did at night either. This imbalance is analogous to archaeologists including only men in their reconstructions of the past and no other genders. What about everybody else? The archaeology of the night is essential to provide balance and perspective to our reconstructions of the past. But this idea is a radical one, because it previously has not been done in archaeology before. I have spent a good deal of my professional life researching the everyday lives of the common people who lived in ancient Maya societies of Central America and Mexico. They left behind a remarkable record of their lifeway. They built grand temple pyramids and palaces and ball courts, monuments and altars, and thousands of houses in their cities in the tropics during the time period that we archaeologists refer to as the Classic. The Classic period is dated from about AD 250 to 900. Until now, our reconstructions of the Classic Maya have favored the day. So, how did the Classic Maya experience the night, and how do we as archaeologists know? Artifacts and architecture will tell us, as well as art and the ancient writings of the Maya themselves and their descendants. The Classic Maya simultaneously feared and revered the night. Their nightscape was full of tropical, fantastical beings, real and imagined, where jaguars roamed and fantastical beings populated the dark. Darkness was not just the absence of light, but represented the time before creation. The night was wild and untamed. The Classic Maya are well known to have been expert astronomers. Today, the field of cultural astronomy attests well to their sophistication in such matters. What happened in the night sky did not just stay in the night sky, for there were dire consequences on this earth. Seeing the stars, the planets, the constellations, the Milky Way, the moon, one could tell whether it was time to plant crops or wage war, for it was written in the stars. Like us, most of the classic Maya would have spent most of their nights at home, so we need to examine the remains of their houses. This focus is called household archaeology. The factors of age and gender and class affected one's housing, but also one's experience of the night. Your time spent at home at night was moderated by whether you were a child or an adult, a man or a woman, a commoner or a noble, for there was inequality in the ancient night. The privileged few spent their nights in grand palaces built of stone that securely kept them tucked away from the dangers of the dark and offered a reprieve from the public. Once inside, they could safely light indoor fires contained in ceramic vessels that warded off the dampness of the dark and any beings that roamed around. The nobles reclined on built-in benches made more comfortable for them with finely woven cloth and curtains for privacy. The classic Maya also wrote about the night. They ritualized the night and they sanctified the night. A precious offering of blood was made by Lady Shuk, queen of Yashilan. Her husband, King Itzamnabalam III, assisted her by wielding a large, heavy torch that illuminated the darkness. On the evening of this performance, on Sunday, October 24th, AD 709, the waxing moon was 90% illuminated, lending additional brightness to this act of devotion. The classic Maya also celebrated the night, and one way to do that is with chocolate. They recorded the ceremony of King An-Ak II, ruler of Piedras Negras and a member of the Turtle Dynasty. In AD 749, this turtle lord celebrated the 20th anniversary of his reign by dancing at midnight and imbibing a hot, inebriating chocolate drink. What about the commoners? How did they experience the night? Their residences were far more common on the landscape, but they were constructed of perishable materials, like the one featured in this photograph. The commoners are the ones who built the temples where the royal people worshipped and buried their dead. The commoners are the ones who built the palaces where the rich lived. The commoners are the ones who built everything else in their society and nourished the nobles with the food that they grew. There is no writing to tell us about this, however, nor whether these activities occurred during the day or the night. However, this constraint should not limit us. Evidence for ancient nights has always been there, but our perception of it has not. We can use everyday artifacts and features to tell us about the night. A hearth during the day is essential for cooking, but at night, it's transformed for socializing and warmth. The earthen floor of a humble house was a work platform by day, but at night, bringing out the sleeping mats, it became a place for sleep. We can also use the present to tell us about the past. I'm thinking of the numerous studies that anthropologists have conducted on contemporary Maya agriculturalists. And if you know anything about farming, a farmer's work is never done, day or night. There are tasks to be accomplished. We can envision classic Maya women involved in the laborious process of preparing maize and beans for the next day's meals and settling in infants and children for the night. Likewise, men would have been involved in provisioning the household. Perhaps they were in the milpas, the cornfields. But darkness was ideal for deer hunting. Once performing the appropriate rituals to ensure their success, men would set out on the hunt. The moon goddess, astride her deer, watched over them. There are many similarities that we modern humans have with the ancient Maya in terms of the night, but there are also some very serious differences, and one of them is the degree of nighttime darkness. In the tropics, night seems to come very quickly as the sun sets abruptly below the horizon. And in the tropics, night and day are of nearly equal length year-round. The classic Maya would not recognize our modern nights. We have learned a lot about the classic Maya by looking at the night because it has added balance and perspective to our reconstruction of their lifeway. But we should be concerned about our modern nights. So bright and intense are the city lights that they drowned out the wonder of the nighttime sky. These lights are so abundant that they can be seen from deep, dark outer space. We need our nighttime stars as much as we need our daytime star to provide balance and perspective to our lives. The visibility of the stars symbolizes our connections to each other, to the past, and to the future. So when you leave here tonight, go outside. Seek out a place where you can see the stars and think about what the night means to you. Thank you.